much for joining us at the Futureprint Tech Fest. And my next guest is Mark Graindoors, who is a business manager for Industrial Inks at AGFA. And good to see you, Mark. Thank you very much for joining us again.
Hi, Fraser. It's always nice to meet you, although it's virtual. But I really like the concept that you have for this time for our attendees, meaning the Tech Fest. So I'm really looking forward to the session. It's a really interesting program.
Thanks, Mark. I guess what would be good, I was just looking at your profile, and we've had you talk a few times on some of our virtual events, and I was thinking before we spoke, I was thinking actually you are one of the most knowledgeable inkjet specialists out there. Just give us a bit of a flavour of your background and you know how you know so much about the inkjet market, and particularly inks, obviously, with the experience from AGFA.
Okay, so I really started 3 days after my PhD. I started at AGFA, which was 1988, so some time ago. And I've been actually in the color graphics market forever. And since 1995, inkjet. So I have seen the evolution of inkjet from a specialty product to, let's say, more a commodity in the good sense, meaning that it's reliable. And of course, AGFA is a big consumable company. So we have chemical expertise. And the combination of having the market input, the technology input from the printer, the know-how about the ink is, of course, a nice situation for myself. But consider this as a team. I'm a face to the public now for AGFA. But it's not my knowledge, of course. It's a team knowledge. Yeah. I'm just trying to capture it and make it value through your channel to the attendees, to the industry, to help each other to use inkjet in a correct way.
And I guess that's really what the theme of this session is. We've talked about our five steps to kind of successful inkjet projects. And when we talked to you about that, you were very clear that, yeah, you're absolutely right. There is this sense that there is a path to follow, and you know, you've been there on a lot of projects and have seen how often people develop the technology and then maybe come to the inks at the final moment, and that perhaps is not the best way of doing it, because you can then take time to develop the ink, and you know, it just puts you back. So it's kind of this idea that there is a path, and actually working together, manufacturer, technology, software, inkjet heads, and also obviously inks, means that you get a more collaborative approach, but you actually end up with the product working to deliver what you want to deliver. Is that right? Is that what kind of the theme today?
Yeah, so when you look to what kind of projects you get new on your table, they come in different ways. So you have your partners, your system integrators, OEMs you work for a long time with, they have a new project, they are approached by an industry and looking for a new system which might be a variation on what they're already doing. Let's say that comes in a very controlled way. But more and more the industries start to look themselves and not let a partner look for them. So they start to look and find the pieces of the puzzle. And that's sometimes a bit worrying, because they do not consider the full puzzle. And I think that's a bit of focus that I've prepared for today. When you start a new project and you've done your analysis and you think, okay, I'm going to profit from all the digital advantages, which is often true, and I want to do that integrated into my processes, how do I start looking into that solution?
Yeah,
really working on the technical solution and not a discussion on the strategy. It's really a bit more practical thinking. I've set my idea, I've made my strategy, I'm sure I can use inkjet and I can believe that. So let's now have a look at it, how to start on this.
Yeah, yeah.
And of course, a bit from an ink perspective.
Yeah, of course. Okay, let's just have a look at your presentation, take us through that path. I think you know, exactly as you said, this is about industrial inkjet printing, single pass UV systems, and looking at it from the point of view of the ink perspective.
Okay, Fraser, just a very short introduction that I'm here in my role as an OEMing partner, so that we work with the system integrators, the OEMs, but also direct with the industries. We focus both on UV inks and water-based inks. So today I will use the example of single pass UV as an example to make you think, but you can also work for other of your projects using water-based ink, etc. It's just a case study on a certain type of project to be used as an example. Okay, so if you can turn up the next slide, I made a schematic graph of how to think about single pass UV inks in your industrial application. So printheads are fixed. The substrate is moving under the printhead array, but you can do much more than just color printing. So if you take CMYK or extra colors, you have them together. You can do intercolor pinning or not, depends on the quality you want, depends on the ink you want. The ink can be designed wet in wet printing, and then the heads can be very closely stacked together, taking very little space, or you can do wet on pin printing. But that's just part of the total solution. So you can integrate a pretreatment or a primer, an analog primer, a digital primer. You can do a pre-white, and you can do a varnish. And every time in single pass, it allows you to, that's why you see the little stopwatch, you can play with the cure delay time. So meaning that you have a perfect homogeneous white by that time, not cure immediately after the white printhead, give it a bit of time, and you form a homogeneous layer. Same with varnish. While after the colors, you can there tune that with maybe a slidable curing unit, so that depending on the substrate, you can extend or shorten the cure delay time for the best optimum quality. But always use the same ink, just change the substrate and the cure delay time. So there's a lot of options. Pretreatment on off depending on the substrate, white on off depending on the substrate. So that's a lot of options you can do in your integration with single pass, which make it quite unique. And of course, when it's linked to the full process, what happens before and after, because it's continuous, and you can arrange the speed and the continuity of the single pass up to your full process. That are the key advantages of single pass. And of course, from an ink perspective, you can do a lot with the white ink, the digital primer, with the colors, the varnish. You can make a full solution approach from an ink perspective towards the print system and the end quality. That's a little bit the schematics I want to represent in this slide to set the scene. One mistake that we could make is see this as a belt-to-belt process. That's by the nature how I made the draft, but that's not the meaning of this. It can be an object printing, direct-to-shape. It can be sheet-to-sheet, roll-to-sheet. It's just a visualization of your single-pass steps. And even on robotics has been done, is being done. But it's just meaning single-pass, it's you place from one color all the dots in one time. You don't build them up gradually. That's a bit the setting of the scene where we consider single pass UV. And now coming to my major slide for today, how is the ink formulation, the ink design, how do we tune that to the result? And the result has, of course, different aspects. You have the system. I take specifically out a printhead. And then, of course, the application. The end user is interested that on the substrate range, the image quality, the durability of the print, and the specific targets he might have for that specific application, that, of course, the result is day by day consistently good. From a technical point of delivering a solution, the print system, the ink wetting on the substrate, the compatibility with the piezo printhead are all key elements. And what I try to say here is a little bit how ink influences important aspects of each of the three blue circles. When we look to the print system, ink supply, I will go a bit more in detail in the next slide. The ink supply is a key element. If your ink is not compliant, compatible with your supply, You don't see it immediately. It takes you months before you see it, but you can lose a lot of time. Which print mode? Are you going to print binary, grayscale? What kind of a drop size? Wet in wet, wet on pin? The cure delay, can you play with it? What kind of curing? What kind of UD dose? Of course, we're mostly talking LED today. And the whole setup, you want primer, white, ink, varnish. So that is a consideration because the ink might depend on it. It will depend on it. Same for the piezo printhead. First thing always we do is printer compatibility check to be sure that the nozzle plate and every part of the printhead is compatible with the ink. Soaking tests, etc., duration tests to be sure. And then, of course, the reliability, drop watcher testing, very much detail at first instance, and control latency, drop formation placement, and long-term, even do an aged ink on a drop watcher to be sure that after the lifetime of the ink, it's still performing very well. And of course, the ink parameters are optimized for a certain printhead. But of course, you have some ranges. It's not so that for every piezo printhead, you need another ink. There are some groups. And waveform is a key element. And those companies that are the system integrator or with the help of specialized people can help you for the waveform so that with a certain ink piezo head combination, you make the best of it for consistent printing. Agfa is a key element of Agfa inks is consistent production of the ink, consistent print results by a good combination ink piezo head waveform. That are key elements. As a general setting, how to see the ink formulation of UV ink towards the signal pass printing. Any comments on this, Fraser?
Yeah, I mean, this is quite a nice schematic, isn't it? It just kind of brings everything in and explains the way you need to think about ink, not just think in terms of the technology first and how important it is that the ink you get right.
It's of course perfectly okay that at the first stage of a project you try to assess what kind of ink type works for my application, and you try to do that as clever as possible without looking to the full printer design. Of course, once you're sure that your ink can deliver your most key priority elements of your application result, then it's time to think about how to build up the print system and am I sure I have selected the right printer? Of course, you do this in steps.
And to put it into context, if you chose to make the machinery first and then came to Agfa and said, we've got a piece of technology, can you now create an ink that works? How long would that take?
It really depends on the application specification. Yeah? The good thing would be, of course, be that we know that print system very well, that we know the ink supply, that it's working, that it's designed to be compatible with UV ink. So we have, let's say that we have some ranges of standard inks that you have. At the first instance, you start with checking a certain standard ink, which you select based on the expectation for that specific application. You do that test, you know it's compatible with the printer and the piezo printhead. You check it for the application. Let's say, okay, we know we need some tuning for image quality, ink wetting, etc. So you know then from an ink designer how to tune your ink to not jeopardize the compatibility with supply, ink supply and printhead, but bring the application specs into scope. So that's exactly the expertise you have. Of course, when it's a total new application and you have no idea which print system will be selected, that's a total other scope. Then you start selecting an ink chemistry type to the application. And the next question will be, okay, what will be the print system look like? So that are basically the two main approaches.
Yeah, and I guess in a way, you want the best of both worlds. You want the ink, the guys who really understand ink and guys who understand the technology and the application. So if they're working together from the start, you're going to get the best of both worlds, aren't you?
Yeah, it's a bit of speed to market. if you use the know-how that is available on the print system part, the printhead type, together with the ink, you're going to go faster. It's going to be the fastest results to know, is my project realistic? And what kind of print system do I need? Keep in mind that such a print system does not need per se to have the transport belt or the transport means inside. It can be an add-on inkjet unit on top to fit in your process. But that unit would consist not just of a printhead, but consist also of the ink supply and the software and the color management and the correct ink. So it's that kind of approach we are thinking of to combine result, fitting the application, and fitting the print system in the fastest possible way with the lowest investment possible. If you use bespoke systems that are existing, that have proven their reliability, you can gain a lot of time in your project.
Shall I move to the next slide?
Yeah, in the next slide we go a bit more practical on this general scheme. Yeah. And let's start with ink supply. You put your ink in an ink supply. We have listings of, we know which kind of ink is compatible with which materials of the ink supply, the pumps, the tubes, the filters, etc. How you can do degassing, when to do degassing, how linked to which speed, control of ink heating. So very important, UV ink is reactive. So it's supposed to cure by UV light. Now it's always a little bit thermal sensitive. So if you jet at a typical temperature, let's say between 40 and 45 degrees Celsius, is a very normal temperature for piezo printer. But during your ink supply, you heat up the ink systematically, repeatedly to 60 degrees. To be sure that it's 45 at the moment it arrives at the print, that you give thermal stress to the ink all the time. If you recirculate and the ink again systematically goes to 60 degrees, you shorten the lifetime of that ink inside of the tubing. So it is a consideration about the ink supply, where, by the way, several of your future print partners are building such high professional supply on different flow rates that people can buy just as an ink supply to be used. The work is done. It's proven material compatibility with UVs and water-based inks, of course, also. It's proved technology that's on the shelf available. And certainly for whiting, it's even a bit more important because the heavy titanium dioxide pigment has a tendency to give some settling depending on the ink. Some inks are better than the other. But agitation in the printer tank is quite a good way to prevent that. So the know-how on all these tricks is available at suppliers. But also on the ink supplier. We have a lot of 50 years experience on UV ink compatibility with ink supply. It's a huge experience that we use together with our ink to advise our customers in the first stage of the project. And there is lessons learned from what not to do. Because if you don't do it correct, you often know it only a few months later. Those months are gone. So that's a big field. Oh, please go back. It's a bit more to tell about that slide, please. So that's only the ink supply part. So for me, that's an element that we should not reinvent all the time. There is a lot done. Good work has been done with many companies where we can advise you what not to do to prevent delay in your project time and get disappointed. That would be the worst thing. Going to the top, the substrate is a key element. Sometimes you have projects, it's one defined class of substrates. So you can very well tune your ink wetting to that specific type of substrate. If it's not possible, when it's, let's say, a very low wetting by the contact angle on that substrate with a very low surface energy, single pass allows you to do a pretreatment, which can be a corona, plasma, or flame. You can do an analog primer, which can be quite a cheap solution. Certainly when you print, want to prime the full substrate, and it's quite wide and big. While in a digital primer can be very interesting when you want to do a limited part of the substrate to print that of the object or the sheet, Let's say you print 20% of that, you do that a digital primer, and exactly on top of that, in one go, you do also the ink on top. So that's really a fantastic concept, where the next slide is a bit more in detail on that digital primer. But that's a way of thinking a bit out of the box. To use a digital primer, UV jettable, to combine with your UV ink. And we see a lot of interest for that specifically. Last but not least, the print heads, as I explained before, material compatibility is really a good cooperation with the print head suppliers and the ink suppliers, that we test very thoroughly the compatibility of ink with all the parts of the print head where the ink is in touch with, in contact with during print. Viscosity, surface tension, a lot of other parameters, particle size distribution, etc., etc., are all important for a long-term reliability result. We have UV inks that are up to 24 months stable, that we give an expiry date 24 months from production. Of course, you also want that a customer is doing repeat shop, the same design every month again, has the same result, even if it's an older batch. So that's the kind of testing we do in-house. That's the kind of testing our OEM customers do. And that, in the end, gives the consistency that the customer wants, the printing company wants. And the waveform, as explained on last slide, is a key element, of course, in making sure that you have no misting, no satellites, no failing nozzles, no deviant nozzles. It's a key part of that. Where drop watcher study is, of course, and real live jetting is a key element to study that. So
and these are, as you said earlier, I guess it's the different possible applications mean, you know, that it could be lots of different application potential with industrial inkjet. This means that you really are good at kind of supporting the company in kind of going through the process of making sure the ink works and the addition to the material is good.
Indeed, yeah. But that's the obvious one, I would say. That's the one everybody is looking into.
Yeah.
But it should not be the only thing looking into. But really, yeah. The relation of the ink chemistry with the end application needs, that's okay in every project. Okay, maybe I'm a bit too fast now to say it's okay in every project. Sometimes we notice that not all aspects are on day one on the table and during the project, extra important features are added. Okay, that can happen. But basically, the end user is, of course, very much interested to know what type of specification is fulfilled. And he knows his market very well. He knows his product very well. So that's basically not a big issue. The big issue is about the relation of ink for a reliable result every day, day by day, day after day. And that is our focus. Because then it's successful. Then it's economic. The right amount of ink, the correct ink, the correct pretreatment if needed, etc. That's the concern where we can guide the end user.
That makes sense. So shall I move to the next slide, Mark?
Yeah. This is something that Agfa has recently added to our portfolio in the Altamira ink range of single pass UV, where we have very good inks by inks that perform very well, but not on every substrate and not for every effect that you want on top of it. So the primer is really a way to consider, let's not change the ink. Let's use the same ink for its durability, for its color strength, for its cure power. Let's stick to the ink and change something by using a jettable primer. So I want a full UV inkjet process, single pass in one step. I add in the same print unit, I had to print the primer. I partially cure that primer. Then I print ink on top, and then I final cure the full package. The partial cure, how does it work? In fact, it means that not all of your acrylates of the primer are bonded or linked, so you have some free available to bond with your ink. That's why we say partial cure. If you would fully cure that primer, then the primer advantage is gone for a big part. It just by having it reactive after your partial cure step, you have the bonding with the ink. In the primer, we put adhesion-promoting acrylates and compounds, which you cannot put in the ink, because it would increase the viscosity too much of your ink, or make your ink very unstable. So adding specific adhesion promoters every time to an ink makes every time different inks. You have to change ink. While here, you just say yes, no with primer. We have two different primers depending on the substrate, which is important for you. And you just play with the primer, and you keep your ink and your color and everything always the same. That's the idea behind the jettable primer. And you have a full digital approach, not analog and primer combined. No pretreatment, no analog primer, a full digital UV single pass solution. That's the concept behind the primer. For the varnish, it's to do something special on top, which is quite popular at the moment, to do some embellishment, tactile, homogeneous gloss, or a spot gloss to highlight something. You can do that on top of the UV print, on another print even. It does not need to be UV print. But it's a UV jettable varnish, single pass, developed, of course, in first instance to jet on top of our ink range, but not only that. So these are what I call enablers. So make our customers' lives easier, because they can keep using the same ink and extend their reach by adding either a primer, either a varnish, or both.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Well, we've got a couple of minutes more. Is there anything you really want to just add in terms of the story? Because I think the point you made, you know, several times is it's quite a complex thing, but you guys have the experience to help any potential customer or current customer on that path. Is there anything you wanted to add to that?
Complex thing, yes and no. Let's say there's a lot of things proven. It's just a question of bringing it all together in the correct way. The pieces of the puzzle, they should be tuned to work for your specific application. So it's not that complex all the time. It depends a bit what you do. Sometimes it's a bit out of the box. Okay, can be more complex on the handling of the object, etc. Yes, can be. But many of the solutions can be a grouping of existing things. Cool. And sometimes, ink design needs to be tuned, but it can be a small tuning. It could be a totally big tuning. So then there is a lot of tune to do from the ink design. So every project is a little bit specific, but can go back to a toolbox, I would say, a modular toolbox. And that's a little bit the message. And the know-how is available, as I said, by many of the of companies, partners of TechFest, of FuturePrint. So there is this know-how in the industry, and one of your roles, as I see this session, is to roll that out to the industry. Look, there is a toolbox. Let's try to use it. I also have a chemical toolbox, of course, where we try to tune that together with the printer toolbox to come to a full solution approach. And is this specific for single pass UV? No. We do the same in water-based projects. Then it's trying with near infrared, for instance, not a UV LED. So there are definitely differences, but the approach is a bit the same.
Yeah, sure.
It's the mentality.
Yeah, I think the point you're making is it sounds complex, but it's not so complex because you have the experience to kind of shortcut for people. So whether they're on the start of the process or in the middle of it, you know, they should be talking to you at least to get some of that knowledge and experience you have, and also that AGFA have in terms of creating inks that work in the right application. Because as you said, you've got this kind of toolbox to work with. So Mark, thank you very much for running through things today. Obviously people, if they want to get in touch with you, we've popped your email address on the website, and you're more than happy to have a chat with people if they're interested to find out more.
Very good. Thank you, Fraser.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. Take care, and catch up with you again soon, Mark.
Yeah, for sure.